Having been in the area and having had the privilege of the touchstones of the various scientists and experts that we've heard from, it gives me, again, a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Walt Boynton. He has been with the Center for Environmental Science, Chesapeake Biological Lab, for quite a period of time and has created a legacy and is still creating many, many new inroads and new insights. And so it's a privilege to have you address how do we relate what is happening in the Choptank to the rest of the Bay tributaries, and can we? So Walter, thank you.
It's always a little scary to be the last speaker on in a long symposium. I remember my colleague Tom Fisher telling me that when he was a graduate student, he had the joy of giving a talk at the last session at an international meeting, and the only person in the audience was his advisor. Anyway, I'm doing a lot better, so that's good. Let me start by just answering the questions that I was tasked with. And the first one is, how do we relate what's happening in the Choptank to the rest of the Bay? And I can say that there's a whole branch of ecology that we use a lot called comparative ecology. It's very insightful. And so the answer to that is, yeah, we can do that. And the answer to the second one, can we and should we, the answer to that is definitely yes. Doing these comparisons tell us something about where we sit and addresses directly the question that this conference is really all about, and that is, are we doing enough? Do we need to do more? Should we be seeing results sooner or later or whatever? The other thing I want to say before I get going here is that In all the examples I'm going to show you, the Choptank River is one of the least nutrient-enriched systems that I'm going to show you. That does not mean that, in my opinion, the Choptank River is in hunky-dory shape. There's plenty of evidence to indicate that there are some bad trends and that we have some work to do. So. Aha. Okay. I'm showing this slide here mainly for those of you who are not in the agricultural world. This is just a fertilization production curve. So what it's saying is that if we add some fertilizer to a plant community, we're going to get some more growth. This is true in estuaries. People have done analyses of this work, this type of idea for estuaries throughout the world, and what we find repeatedly is that as nitrogen and phosphorus are added to these systems, they become more productive. Technically, we call the sweet spot here mesotrophic, which means really well-fed. What we're concerned about is that we go beyond these limits in some of these systems. So the point here is that nitrogen and phosphorus are essential for plant and animal growth. I've told audiences before who talk about nitrogen and phosphorus as strictly a pollutant that they're wrong. Nitrogen and phosphorus is the stuff of life. Without nitrogen and phosphorus, we would be toast. Well, actually, we would not be toast because there's some nitrogen and phosphorus in toast. All right, so in some ways, this is a serious environmental problem in many estuaries around the world, but I would also say that it's a much better, more solvable problem than some estuaries have, those that are chock-a-block full of lead and mercury, and some of the really bad organic compounds. They have a really, really bad problem. Those things are poison. We've got too much of a good thing. And that's a far more solvable problem. Not an easy one, by the way, but a better problem to have. So within limits, increased fertilization increases production. No mystery there. In estuaries, we start to also get negative effects. Beyond a certain level, these negative effects include blooms and odors, the creation of dead zones, which you probably read about in the papers, decreased water clarity, loss of seagrasses, and disruption in normal estuarine food webs. And so, we have a bunch of places in Chesapeake Bay which are in this eutrophic range that's highlighted in that bottom slide. What we need to do and what we're trying to do is back away from that, back into the more mesotrophic, high production, no negative or few negative consequence range. So, simple, right? Unfortunately, not so simple. I'm showing you this. These are a set of curves, and we call them ecosystem responses to nutrient degradation and remediation or restoration. In the upper left, there's a very simple sort of curve, two curves, in fact. And what it's really showing us is that if we increase the nitrogen or the nutrient load going along the x-axis, we start to increase the amount of algae, hypoxia, turbidity. We decrease the amount of seagrasses. We simplify the primary producers. We change the biogeochemistry. We do all kinds of screwy things to estuaries, none of which are particularly good. All right, now, if we start reducing the nitrogen and phosphorus loads in that upper left-hand panel, the system tracks right back down the same pathway. So for every little change in nutrient load, we get a very predictable change in ecosystem response. However, there are three other pathways that are also shown there. They have all been seen in the real world, so this is not, you know, hypothetical ecological dreaming. This is real world stuff. And so we see things like threshold recoveries. In the bottom left, we see something with a threshold, but some wandering and some time delays before something happens. And then in the bottom right, we see what we call a shifting baseline, where when we start back from a damaged condition, we never get back to where we hope we would be. One of my points in showing you this is that this is one of the reasons why we're here today. We are wondering whether we have done enough. Should we be seeing stronger responses than what we are? And the answer to that could be in one of these diagrams. I suspect that it probably is. So, I'm also going to refer to some of these, particularly that threshold recovery in the upper right later on in this talk. So, even though it's late in the day and you've heard a lot of stuff, try to keep that little piece in mind. One thing we're sure of, okay, and I think scientists across the world would agree with that, is that there's plenty of additional room for degradation. We could get something like this, which is a microcystis bloom in the Potomac River. We don't want that. Our Chinese friends have done this kind of experiment repeatedly. This is a beach in China where there has been just a huge amount of nitrogen and phosphorus released to coastal waters, and they get these horrible algal blooms. All right, in this figure here, I put together the amount of nitrogen and phosphorus, phosphorus on the horizontal axis, nitrogen on the vertical axis, from a whole bunch of estuaries from different places around the world, including Chesapeake Bay. So we see that there's a terrific range in the amount of nitrogen and phosphorus getting into these systems. Phosphorus loads vary about by three orders of magnitude going into these estuaries. Nitrogen by two orders of magnitude or a titch more. Those red little squares up there are from the Patuxent River estuary for a 13-year period. And what we see is that the amount of nitrogen that gets into these systems, or phosphorus, varies on an interannual basis. And basically, for many of the systems in the Chesapeake, the variation is by about a factor of two. Sometimes it's a little more than that, sometimes a little less. But a lot of the big river systems during a dry year input a certain amount of nitrogen, whereas in a wet year, it'll be twice as much. So there's a lot of variability, and that is one of the reasons why it is really difficult to, in the short run, and we heard about this about long-term monitoring this morning, why it's very difficult in the short run to tell whether something is changing, because one of the main forcing features of these systems changes a lot on an interannual basis. Finally, the Back River, which is up near Baltimore, receives a lot of both urban runoff and discharge from a sewage treatment plant. Is a heavily loaded system, particularly with nitrogen. And if we take my kind of science units and turn them into units that people in this room would understand, then the loading to the Back River is around 900 pounds of N per acre per year, which is a bodacious amount of nitrogen. And of course, that poor little ecosystem turns green for many months of the year. So it is super overloaded. So where's the Choptank? Well, here's the Choptank. It's in the moderate range. It is not one of the heavily loaded systems, nor is it one of the systems that receives a very low load. I had a conversation, or I've had conversations with Tom Fisher about where this dot is sitting, and we're in general agreement about the nitrogen, and we both agree that it's probably underestimating the amount of phosphorus getting into the Choptank because most of the phosphorus coming in travels during storms and rainfall events, and those are not well sampled. So we're probably underestimating the phosphorus input. So in the Choptank, we're getting about 80 pounds of N per acre per year and about two pounds of phosphorus per acre per year, and the phosphorus number is probably low. Now, one of the things an engineer would think, well, if this is how much gook we're putting into a reactor, like an estuary, how much do we measure once we go and measure it in the estuary? Does the estuary reflect the inputs? And this little summary of data, which I could have made a lot more complicated than this, what it indicates is what it says at the top. What you put in is what you get. So as the load increases, the mass of nitrogen in these estuaries also increases, and that is reflected in the growth of algae and so forth. This relationship is not as strong for phosphorus. It's there, but it's not as strong, and that's very probably because so much phosphorus is attached to dirt, and dirt sinks faster than biology. So it's not in the water column as long. We know that there's a big range in the amount of chlorophyll in the water, how green the water is. And here's an example of just three places, the Choptank, the Patuxent, and this Back River estuary up near Baltimore. And we can see that the Choptank, again, here is on the low end, the Patuxent is higher, and the Back River is out of sight. This is in response to the amount of nitrogen getting into these systems. It's also in response to many, many other things, but in this example, the amount of fertilization is really important. We can do better than that, and we have. Here's an example where we're showing other systems in the Chesapeake Bay. And again, the Choptank comes out at the lower end of this. So what we're showing here is the amount of algal blooming, that's on the vertical, the vertical axis, and nutrient loading rate. Now, the nutrient loading rate has been quote unquote scaled to make these systems more comparable. So that it's scaled by how deep the systems are and how long the water hangs out in those systems. That's called water residence time. And we know that's an important property of all of these systems. So as the water residence time becomes shorter and shorter and shorter, the nutrient load becomes less and less effective. So when water hangs around a long time, the biology has a chance to get at those nutrients. That's been a pretty clear finding. So the Choptank is on the lower end of this scale. In terms of hypoxia, we see the same sort of thing. As the nitrogen load increases, we see places like the York River, the Rappahannock, the Patuxent, the Main Stem, and the Potomac all increasing with the amount of hypoxic water in those systems. And we see the Choptank sitting down there pretty low. In fact, using these criteria of oxygen concentrations of less than 2 milligrams per liter, the Choptank is pretty much zeroed out. That's not to say that we could not generate dead zones in the Choptank. We could. And if nitrogen and phosphorus loads, increase appreciably, that's exactly what we would predict. I want to show you this diagram, and it relates back to the first one that I showed you, one of the first ones I showed you, about how these systems can respond in a linear fashion or a more complicated fashion. This is the phosphorus cycle in an estuary where oxygen conditions are good. I can also say, this is the phosphorus cycle in the Choptank River estuary most of the time. And what you need to know here is that POP, POP, really think algae. POP is algae. So let's take a look at this. Phosphorus gets into the water from whatever source, algae take it up. They need it to grow. They have short lifetime. When they die, they sink to the bottom of the estuary. And that POP then is remineralized by bacteria and goes back to being phosphorus, phosphate, the kind of phosphorus plants can use. However, in a system where there's oxygen available, that oxygen is in the deep water and it's also in the sediments, and that oxygen reacts with iron and makes an basically rust. And rust reacts with phosphorus. So it takes dissolved phosphorus that's in those sediments and makes it into a solid form. So it is not going back to the water. In fact, it's going to get buried over the long term. It is out of sight, out of mind. And if that was carbon, I'd say it's on its way to making coal. But it's not carbon, it's phosphorus, but it's still getting buried. And so as a result, we get some very modest return of phosphorus to the water column. This is a buffering effect. And this is the way estuaries around the world work with phosphorus, if there's any iron in the sediment at all, and most of them have some. So this is what happens in the Choptank most of the time, and that's a good thing. Here's what happens when we have some lack of oxygen in the water. So phosphorus is picked up by algae, the algae sink, the phosphorus is remineralized to PO4, but oxygen does not get down to the bottom. It does not get into the sediments. So as a result, there's no ferric oxides created. There is no absorption of P onto those particular pieces of sediment. And in fact, quite a bit of phosphorus is reduced. But then it gets even worse because the microbes start using sulfur in place of oxygen to quote unquote breathe. And that reaction kicks that phosphorus back into solution and makes for a huge phosphorus flux from the sediments to the water. So that's the kind of thing where if we start to get some hypoxic water, things can get much worse, much faster than what we would expect. Conversely, if we have hypoxic water and we do things to get rid of it, like reduce the algal biomass, which is reduced by reducing the amount of nitrogen and phosphorus coming into the system, we get the reverse reaction, where all of a sudden, this big source of phosphorus becomes a small and essential source of phosphorus. So we've actually seen this in the Choptank River. On the right-hand side, when oxygen is high in the bottom waters, the phosphorus flux is real small. In fact, it is about the same as we see in non-eutrophic estuaries around the world. There have been a few occasions, and fortunately there have been only a few occasions, where we measured the phosphorus release from these sediments when the oxygen was low. And we see that it's really high. It's 30 units. That's enough phosphorus to grow some bodacious algal blooms. And that's something we want to avoid. So I think there is reason to believe that we could see some really threshold responses, both in the good way and the bad way, for a system like the Choptank. So the take-home messages here are that there's a very large range in water quality conditions in bay tributaries, very large range. The tributaries examined, the Choptank does not have many characteristics associated with intense nutrient over-enrichment. It's got some symptoms of nutrient over-enrichment, and some of those have been going in the wrong direction for quite a while. Comparisons among bay tributaries are very possible and useful because they indicate where the tributary sits on the eutrophication spectrum. And we need to be very aware of water quality thresholds like this low DO business in phosphorus. And that's just one example of a half a dozen of these thresholds that are possible. And these need to be avoided. Let me conclude by saying a few things. And I'll preface these by saying that my wife says, we've had these references to wives today, so what the heck, that I wander through life, I agree with the wandering part, with rose-colored glasses on. Nevertheless, I've heard some things today that make me feel pretty optimistic about the Choptank River and the future. One of them is there are some astounding things happening in the agricultural community. For someone who is not an agricultural person, these things are eye-opening and I think are incredibly positive. The second thing is, we have seen in the presentations today some hints, maybe we could call them subtle signals of threshold responses in the Choptank. They may or may not be real, but they're there, and they fit the model. That is the model of how we think about these systems. One of them is, in the last couple of years, the water has clarified a good deal. That generally happens when nutrient load reductions occur, even if the reductions are small. Secondly, we've seen a little bit of reduction, again, just in recent years, of chlorophyll in the water column. Tom talked about that. Someone showed a picture today that contrasted 2010 and 2015 seagrasses in the Choptank, and the difference was horrendous. Seagrasses are like kidneys in our body, and they are starting to reline the shore of the Choptank. That is real important. That's the kind of thing that will kick off a threshold response, okay? Because they intercept and do away with nutrients, they reduce turbidity, they do all kinds of positive things. And the last one is that, now I'm really on thin ice, so if you have a tomato, throw it. And that is that I was very impressed a few years ago when I saw the work that Russ Brinsfield and Kenny Staver did with cover crops. And what they showed was in corn production fields, when they started planting fall cover crops, that the root zone nitrate concentration went from maybe 15 to 20 milligrams per liter down to 2 or 3 or 4 milligrams per liter. But that took about 6 years. That didn't happen overnight. That took time. And when someone else showed a figure of the amount of land in, I believe, Maryland, that is in the cover crop program, above 70,000 acres, that was, interestingly enough, 6 years ago. Okay, so on some of these things, we simply need to be patient. I don't know if we have done enough or not, but I do know for some of these things, particularly things like groundwater, we need to be patient. We are not going to see instantaneous responses. So my rose-colored glasses say, hey, there's some glimmers of hope here. We ought to keep going. We certainly shouldn't relax. But if we need some positive signs, we have seen a few. Thank you.
And I'd also like to, in addition to inviting Walt to the table, to have Tom, Joel, Rich, Bruce come up as well. I have a handful of remaining questions that were not able to be asked this morning, and we're going to go through them. And thank you all for your kind attention throughout this entire symposium. I know I've learned a lot. I hope you have as well. I certainly have an inkling now as to where things stand, and Walt, with your concluding comments, I'm ready to put on some rose-colored glasses as well. The question here is for Tom Fisher. What can the residential sector do to improve cooperation, as two-thirds of the farmers are working with your agency?
Well, I think I won't limit this to just the experimental watersheds where we're working. If you're a resident, there's two really, at least two important things you could do. One is if any of you are applying lawn fertilizers, just stop. There's no, growing a green lawn is not a productive use of fertilizers. It doesn't do anything except cause you to have to cut your grass more often. That's not my favorite exercise, and I doubt it's yours. So you can have a perfectly green lawn. It may not be that perfect chem lawn that you see on the TV ads, but you can, the loss of nitrogen from fertilized turf can be almost as high as from a cornfield, and it earns you nothing except labor. Second thing, many counties have, most counties have programs to convert your septic system, if you have one, to a denitrifying unit, which is called a BAT. That's a weird acronym, best available technology. It's really a system that takes the nitrogen in your waste and turns it into N2 gas. The counties pay for the entire installation process. You have a few fees to pay. You have to pay an additional $5 to $20 a month to pay for the pumps that run the thing. The county runs it for 5 years for you, and then you take it over after 5 years. It's a really simple thing to do. It tears up your yard for a few weeks while you get it installed, and after that, you have a system that will take your nitrogen out of the watershed and a large fraction of it, and you can feel like you're making a contribution to reduce how much nitrogen and phosphorus are getting into the chop tank or whatever body of water that you're living in. Another option would be rain barrel. If you have areas in your yard that are eroding, especially near your downspouts, you can put in rain barrels. There's lots of options for getting them installed, and you get to water your garden for free with those as well. So there's lots of things that an individual landowner can do to make their contribution. And one of the hardest things that we've found in our experimental watersheds is getting the interest of the residents who live in a watershed. We've had great success with the farmers. We've had very poor success with residents. So I would encourage any of you who have your own home in this area to pay more attention to some of these programs and to join in yourself personally.
Thank you. This one's for Walt from your buddy Nick Carter. I think he wrote this to see if I could remember how to pronounce these words. What differences in situation between mesohaline, oligohaline, tidal fresh portions of chop tank in ray phosphorus flux?
I couldn't hear wrong.
Again, so she said, what's the difference between tidal fresh, oligohaline, mesohaline in terms of top phosphorus flux?
Oh, okay.
He's getting old, so we can help him out.
God bless me, I am getting old. in the salty parts of the bay, even if it's not very salty, they are really, really sensitive to releasing phosphorus if there's no oxygen in the water. Very, very sensitive. Less so in the tidal fresh areas. They will release phosphorus if there's no oxygen in the water, but not at the horrendous rate that it will in the salty water. So, and in different parts of the bay where we've seen some improvements, have been actually quite a few places where there have been improvements, have been up in that oligohaline tidal fresh areas.
Thank you. This is a general question regarding denitrification. Does the nitrogen gas impact global warming, such as with methane?
No.
Thank you. Another general question. Is there concern for water quality issues beyond nutrients and eutrophication? Examples, salinization of fresh water, raw salt, and irrigation, toxics, endocrine disruptors, water quality, flow characteristics.
Yes.
Let me just add something to Rich's terse answer. You can find examples of probably all of those all around the bay. Places where you're getting saltwater intrusion into groundwater aquifers, where you've got trace metals or toxics that are discharged. They're not as widespread as nitrogen and phosphorus pollution, however. So they exist. They're more localized, but they're not. And there are places where it's a serious issue, but there are. I'll go out on a limb here. There are none that I can think of in the chop tank.
Great. Thank you. This is for Bruce. Judy Denver is doing research in the Chester River watershed on ag land and is showing the groundwater nitrogen in the youngest groundwater under 10 years is greatly improved compared to oldest groundwater. She credits cover crops. Would you expect the same improvements in Choptank groundwater?
That's for me.
That's what it has on here, but I think, yeah.
I don't think I'm the right one to
address that.
I would send that to Tom.
I think that goes to Tom or myself, and I think, yes, we would expect to see that the improvements that we're seeing in shallow groundwater will eventually be moving into the deeper groundwater in our streams.
We've actually done some measurements on a on some farms in Talbot County where active grain production was retired to conservation practices at different times, and we sampled the groundwater under these areas with varying age since active grain production. And what we saw was that the nitrate in groundwater went from about 10 milligrams per liter, where it typically is under agricultural fields, and over the course of 3 to 5 years, it decreased to about one or less than 1 milligram per liter. Now, we were sampling the top of the what's called the unconfined aquifer, the aquifer that receives recharge from the surface soils. So this was a well underfunded project, so we could only sample the top of the aquifer. I think if we could have gone deeper into the unconfined aquifer, we'd have still seen more nitrate further down. But what was interesting about this is in a very short period of time, 3 to 5 years, you could see a dramatic change in the amount of nitrate in the top of the aquifer. So it would probably take longer, maybe double that time to get further down into the unconfined aquifer down to 6 or 9 feet, it might have been maybe down to 15 feet or 20 feet. But you can see when you make a dramatic change in the land use, the groundwater responds in a very short time. The question then becomes, how long does it take that cleaner groundwater to move to the nearest stream and show up in surface water? So, but you know, I personally have not seen a lot of evidence of big changes in groundwater, except in places where there have been very big changes in land use, major changes in management.
Okay, thank you. The next series of questions pertain to wetlands, and they aren't directed at anyone in particular. And they're as follows. Is it generally known that this loss of marshlands is occurring, and what is the long-term effect on the Choptank if the marshes disappear, and what can be done about it? Now, there's a corollary to this, too, and that is, what is causing the disappearance of our marshes, and how is this affecting water quality, and what can be done about it? Would you like to take
that? Sure, so I'll take that. we are looking into wetlands some, we being NOAA and part of our Choptank habitat focus area efforts. I guess, you know, in terms of what's affecting them, it's probably a lot of things. You know, I know development, shoreline hardening is causing loss of some of those near shore marshes and wetlands. So that's an issue to be concerned about. Sea level rise, as I talked about, is also a major stressor in this system. As water level rises, the marshes, at least in some areas, can't keep up with that rise in water and die as a result. You know, if any of you have driven through Blackwater recently, that's a really good example of where you're seeing, you know, where you're seeing all those dead trees is where you're getting saltwater intrusion into those high marshes, and they're just, you know, the marshes are eroding away. So similar things are going to happen or are happening in this system. So I think it's trying to, now there may be areas where the marshes can migrate, but they've got to have room behind them to move inward or landward as the sea level rises, but we want to try to get a better sense of where those, what we would call sort of migration corridors exist. To get a sense of, you know, how you might expect marsh wetland changes in the system look given certain sea level rise projections. So.
Thank you. And there was another person who also was looking at the impact of wetlands on nutrient removal, and particularly nutrient loading in the upper watershed is high while the bottom oxygen below is pretty good, so are the fisheries. So the question was, would you comment on the potential impact of wetlands on nutrient removal?
Wetlands on nutrients?
Yeah, tidal wetlands?
Just says impact of wetlands on nutrient removal.
A few years ago, we did a pretty careful study of nutrient sources and sinks in the Patuxent River estuary, where the nutrient loads are about twice what they are in the Choptank. And what we found was that it was pretty remarkable, was that about half of all of the nitrogen and phosphorus that gets to a stream and to tidal waters in that estuary were removed either through denitrification or long-term burial by the tidal marshes in that system. I tend to believe those results because we did the computations by looking at direct measurements made in the Patuxent. Then we redid the computations using values from the world literature. And then we redid the computations using other measurements besides the direct ones we had, and they all converged. So the end answer was that in that part of the Patuxent, which is most of the basin, that include the tidal marshes, 1.5% of the landscape removed 50% of the nitrogen and phosphorus that entered the system. So my view is that, and that's not unique to the Patuxent, my view of these wetlands, whether they're tidal or not, are they're nutrient sponges. Grace Brush from Hopkins has looked at paleo, old-time records of the basin, back before the Europeans got here. And one of her distinct conclusions was that the basin was soggy. And the reason it was soggy was that in every stream, first, second, and third order stream, beavers had built multiple dams. And that modulated the nutrient supply to the bay. So I think when we think about, nutrients coming off the landscape, wetlands can play a very big role in intercepting those. So I'm a big wetland fan.
Thank you.
Can I jump in real quick,
sure,
too? Not about necessarily the nutrient mitigation, but I heard the word fish in there somewhere in the question. I'm not sure exactly what it's getting at. But, I mentioned that we're seeing, differences in or changing shorelines in the Choptank overall, that they're becoming more hardened, whether it's bulkhead or riprap. And these nearshore marshes, though, are really important for fish habitat, especially smaller fish, whether they're juvenile fish, they're developing into adults, or they're just smaller sort of bait fish, which are important for supporting things like striped bass. So maintaining those nearshore habitats where you have a marsh at the shoreline is really critical. So back to when Tom was talking about some things that people can do, on their lawns, if you're also a waterfront owner, there are things you can do at your nearshore line to ensure that it's providing better habitat for fish. And, those hardened shorelines also create, higher energy systems, more erosion. And so I think it's just another thing to consider when we're talking about overall, conservation of this watershed.
I'll just add one other thing as well. If you've ever gone up the Choptank River, you'll notice that starting around Chancellor's Point, right where the river makes about a right angle turn to the left, you start to see wetlands all along along the shoreline there, and those are very common in estuarine systems in that transition zone between tidal low salinity water and tidal fresh environment. So there's a whole series of plants that live sort of kind of between Chancellor's Point and then all the way up to where the Tuckahoe and the Choptank come together. That region is just full of wetlands on either side, and I had a master's student who looked at one of those creeks, tidal creeks, receives the effluent from the East and Wastewater Treatment Plant, And so we did a little mass balance of how much was coming out of the plant and how much was actually exiting the mouth of that marsh. And even though it was only about a kilometer or so, maybe half a mile of winding marsh that went between the outlet of the wastewater treatment plant and the Choptank, we could only account for about half of the nitrogen and phosphorus that left the wastewater plant, actually came into the Choptank. So I don't think they did that by design, but it was a happy accident that they were getting a tertiary treatment effect by that water that was sloshing back and forth in that tidal channel between the outlet, which was in freshwater, and the oligohaline part of the Choptank, right below Dover Bridge. So marshes are really useful for as habitat and as sort of biological reservoirs that are sort of sucking up nitrogen and phosphorus that we spill willy-nilly throughout the watershed.
Thank you. Has the comprehensive, quote, limiting factors analysis, end quote, been undertaken to adequately rank the problems most impacting the Choptank?
Limiting in what sense? Does it, is can the, someone clarify that? I don't understand.
Is the person who asked or sent in this question, yes. Could you?
The concern I have is there's multiple variables affecting the Choptank as an ecosystem, beyond just nitrogen, phosphorus, sediment. There are a whole range of other issues with regard to precipitation, endocrine disruptors, toxins of all sorts. You know, in order to effectively facilitate recovery, I think it's important to have a big picture of understanding what is most controlling the degradation of the system. That's what I mean by living in fact.
Okay. Thank you.
Looking at me.
I'm looking at the entire table.
I think given what Bill said, no, I don't think that's been done. I think we have a lot of the capacity to do that. Certainly on the nutrient sediments, climate change elements of it, chemical contaminants, I think Tom dealt with that, there's a certainly more local pieces. Bill, I think it's a good point. We always, you know, you're right that we put a lot of focus on the nitrogen phosphorus sediment. We added the wetlands in there. I still think you're going to come out with basically the same kind of conclusions. I think we've been focused on the right places, but it's always good to keep that well-rounded picture out there. So, good comment.
Well, just I was just going to add, because you mentioned ocean acidification. I mean, there are some of those emerging issues, right, like climate change. We mentioned sea level rise. You're the first one to mention ocean acidification today. NOAA is also looking into that. We've got some work that we're looking to fund here, do some monitoring. There's also Jeremy Testa, who's in, I don't think I saw him here today, but he's doing some work on ocean acidification. So what I'm getting at here is I do think that we need to continue to fund and support those science needs to better understand what the impacts of those other issues are. So just throw that in.
Thank you. If high stream flow events are the strongest drivers of phosphorus export, are best management practices designed for peak functionality at high flow rates? And if climate change is increasing the intensity of the strongest rainfall events and increasing duration of dry spells, are today's best management practices adequately designed for future precipitation regimes in which the 100-year event is frequently exceeded?
I can address that. I think in general, we're not planning enough for dealing with storm flows. There are storm detention ponds, there are sediment ponds. Winter cover crops certainly help because they stabilize the soil, and much of the responses, well, you get the distribution of rainfall is fairly even throughout the year, but evapotranspiration is very high in the summer, so the soils dry out, you get a rain event, and the soil absorbs a lot of it. In the wintertime, however, you have cold, damp conditions, soils are saturated with water, close to close to it, so you get a big rain event. So the same rain event in January has a much bigger impact than a rain event in July in terms of overland flow and erosion. So winter cover crops are the first line of defense against keeping that soil in place and not having having soil erosion, leaching of phosphorus, leaching of nitrate out of surface soils, and sort of driving fluxes into streams. Stream buffers, I think, are not just mowed grass, occasionally mowed grass buffers, but forested buffers would be an even stronger line of defense, because they are going to be along the length of a stream and act to trap some of the sediment, nitrogen, phosphorus that would otherwise run across a grass buffer or no buffer at all. So having a sort of a physical and biological barrier along the edge of a stream really helps to control how much is lost during large storm events. One of the problems with grassed and forested buffers is that right now, with the payment that farmers get for the CREP program for setting aside land that could otherwise be farmed alongside streams, the payments are lower now than what they can make by growing crops on them, even with the relatively low grain prices that are there now. And so a lot of land that was in buffers is coming, as the contracts expire, and they're 10-year contracts, when they expire, they're not going back into buffers, they're going back into cropland. So that's a place where I think USDA is not, and RSCS are not paying enough attention to the land rent that's paid for buffers relative to the crop prices. So that's an area where I think we could do a better job of mitigating the effects of storm events by having buffers along streams.
Take it even further, and that is oftentimes, I don't know, with Maryland, DC, and others, we're still managing stormwater in our urban suburban areas for a 1, maybe 2-inch storm. Mm-hmm. But witness what Ellicott City saw when I was out in the Pacific Northwest. They're designing for 5, 6, 7-inch storms out there. Yes, they get a lot more rain than we do, but they're looking ahead to climate change as well. So no, I don't think our BMPs are getting smarter, but we're thinking still in terms of rain events a decade or two ago. We got to catch up with what we're actually starting to see out there now.
Great. Thank you. And Tom, this is for you, and they're both somewhat interrelated with regard to best management practices. 15 watersheds, 8 improving, 5 no change, and 2 degrading. Is there an assessment of what differences in practices are causing? Are they causing improvement versus degradation? And then, are 26 BMPs in that 6-square-mile area about the number you expected to install and that you expected to make a difference?
Okay, multiple part question there. So I have not yet I don't have the data on best management practices within all 15 of those watersheds. We're in the process of getting the information on the best management practices in our 4 watersheds that we're doing the intensive studies on, where we're working with all the farmers. So I can't really answer the question, you know, whether that 8 that showed some improvement in water quality had extraordinary numbers of BMPs or not. It would be nice to show, if that in fact was the case, that'd be very nice to be able to show. But I don't know the answer to that yet. With regard to the number of best management practices, when I wrote my research proposal, I sort of sat back and said, okay, well, how many BMPs is it going to take to make some improvement? And I really didn't have a very good idea. So I think I wrote in the proposal that we're going to try to get 20 to 30 in each of those experimental watersheds. So we're 2 years in or so on this, 2.5 years in on this project, and we've gotten a total of 26 in 3 watersheds. So that's below my expectations. But we're only halfway into this project, and we're still working with as many of the farmers as we can to try to get them to do additional things that we have funding for, or where we're able to to convince them that it's a good idea for them to be doing it. So I'm hoping that we'll get more than 26. Whether it's enough, I don't know. The whole intent of this project is to monitor the hell out of these places and say, when we do these things, what changes in water chemistry do we actually see? And so in about two more, well, at the end of this, at the end of the five-year project, we're going to have a big sort of symposium, and maybe we can, it can be incorporated into one of these, where we're going to lay out the results. What did we see? How many BMPs were we able to get in? What were the changes in water quality that we saw? Which ones appear to work? Which ones don't seem to work? And so I'll be in much better position to answer those kind of questions at the end of this process.
Great. Thank you. Rich, this is for you. Explain Tom Fisher's data and what it shows. Now, this is a little, this gets into a little bit. And actually, the bottom question is a really interesting one. Nitrogen, average of 4.67 milligrams per liter. Phosphorus, average of 0.067 milligrams per liter. Greensboro Station, nitrogen 1.87 milligrams per liter, and phosphorus at 0.117 milligrams per liter. If Greensboro Station is a model calibration point, we are not representing the average nutrient levels of the river, are we, or are we not?
And yeah, you're correct. Yeah, Greensboro has been one of those things that, as we've said, we've had a long-term station there for 30 plus years. Previous models, we did calibrate the Delmarva Peninsula based on that one. We knew it was wrong. We worked with our USGS partners. EPA brought a bunch of funding to the table, got funding to Maryland, Virginia, and Delaware. We've got, I think you corrected me, six stations?
Seven
across the Delmarva that we at least have a 10-year record on. That Greensboro has been one. I know, Tom, you've actually filtered more nutrients out of there than farmers have as well over the past 45 years. So we're fortunate we're not no longer calibrating on the basis of that one alone. We've got a range of them, as I mentioned, Nanticoke, Broad, Pocomoke, some others up down there, up in the Chester as well. So a good point. It is not characteristic. It is a unique small watershed up there, but I think we've got better information. Not only that, we've got better land use. We've got better understanding of phosphorus-saturated soils. So it's not just models are certainly unique to do, but they don't rely only on calibration. That is sort of our key point. We've gotten much better input information. We're bringing in groundwater components from USGS. And as I said also, we look at how much we're assuming is coming off that watershed, and we then also calibrate the Monocacy and the Wicomico. All the Eastern Shore rivers as well have got, we're fortunate to have 30 plus years of monitoring data in the tidal waters themselves. So I think a combination that we've got a lot more confidence in the science, another 10 years worth of monitoring data at seven different stations as well. In terms of explaining Tom Fisher, God, that could take a long time. But we have an evening session devoted to that.
With alcohol involved, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Tom, the Choptank was targeted to have a higher concentration of nutrients than the Susquehanna. But would not the Susquehanna have a much higher total load? And would that not be more important than concentration?
Yeah, there's a scaling issue here. I tend to work with concentrations because they're simple, they're easy to understand. You can compare the concentration of one body, one river to another, and so it's that makes it easy. But there is a scaling issue in the sense that the Susquehanna River is much bigger than the Choptank River at Greensboro. But on the other hand, the volume of the Chesapeake Bay is a lot bigger, that's what the Susquehanna flows into, than the volume of water in the Choptank. And so the scaling is about the same. And so I think you can still make comparisons just based on concentrations. Loads are much more quantitative, and for the Bay program and for modeling purposes, you need to have loads. But for just explaining to someone, you know, what are the major sources of nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment coming into a system, you can simply use concentrations to compare whether something is a large source or a small source in terms of the just what's, you know, what the quality of the water is coming in. And I like to show I like to show people who think that the Susquehanna is the source of all evil for water quality in Chesapeake Bay, and it's simply flowing in and somehow flowing up the Choptank and into freshwater streams, that the sources of nitrogen and phosphorus in the upper Choptank are much higher than anything than the average concentration in the Susquehanna. And so I acknowledge that there are limitations to that approach, but it's a very simple, clear way to explain the relative cleanliness or water quality in different bodies of water.
Yeah, I think as Joel had indicated, and our USGS partners are convincing other partners, concentration has got its utility, but just for what the person was asking, moving more towards yield, which gives you the land area and the load itself, so that allows you to look within that system. The other piece is, as Tom was indicating, and I showed you at least for the Choptank, not all river systems are created equal, not only influencing themselves, but influencing others. We're working on where I showed you the 10 major rivers and how they influenced each other. We're actually, with the new science and understanding we've got from the estuary, from Walter's work and others, going to be able to take it down so we can look segment by segment. The partnerships divides not just the Choptank up, but all our tidal waters up into 92 segments in which we have monitoring, and we look at those sort of on an impairment basis as well. We'll be able to then look at how each of those segments, it could be the upper, lower, middle, upper, middle, or lower Choptank, the lower, other parts of the Choptank in the Eastern Bay, and be able to say that segment relative to everyone else around it, who's influencing it, so that we can take that chart that I showed and get more specific of saying, okay, not that we want to blame your neighbors per se, but we want folks to understand how much are they responsible for and who else do they need to be sure it's under the big tent to do it. So there are ways to get away from just concentration and put it so that we can weigh small rivers to big ones to themselves and then their contribution to others as well. So not just all the muddy Susquehanna, we certainly have got to do that, but as we showed for the Choptank, or you go onto the western shore in the Rappahannock, folks got to do a large part of it themselves, but they also have to depend on others to help them out.
Great. Thank you. And we have four remaining questions. This goes to you, Rich. 2015 was indeed a remarkable year. You seem to suggest it is a sign that our restoration efforts have begun to take hold. Why would that cause such a dramatic one-year change instead of a gradual change? And are you implying that we should expect coming years to be just as great without spikes in rainfall?
Yeah, I'd like to first to take credit for 2015. It was one of those head-scratchers, not just for clarity, but for others. Certainly this past year, not until in the August time period, did we actually start to see some strong anoxic conditions out in the main stem. So it was, I think the signal is not just that one particular time period, but 2015 was unique because of we didn't have the usual dry spring that set up for good conditions in that. And certainly being in the Chesapeake for 30 plus years, when I was kayaking out there and neighbors and people that knew I worked for the partnership here said, man, that's the first time I've ever seen off of my dock or off of so-and-so. We don't want it. It's not necessarily an anomaly, but I think what Walter and others have said, that we keep finding that the Chesapeake's memory is not as long as we thought it was. And it's not just clarity, it's not just dissolved oxygen, not just grasses, but we're seeing a whole host of other signals that there's a state change, not only in the Choptank, but we're seeing in the Susquehanna, we're seeing it on the James. There's other parts of the system that are showing us clear signals. And when you have a couple of those things done, when you see water clarity perhaps better than we've seen in 30, 40 years, bay-wide, it tells you that you're not there yet, but the system is saying, I can respond. But you've got to hold back a lot more when we get into those rainy years and those other years as well. So I think the bottom line is a bunch of us are seeing a number of signals across multiple watersheds that individuals in our collective actions are making a difference. Again, not sit back on the laurel because we're gonna have another million people in another 10 years, but it's clearly saying we're making a difference against, when I started 12 million people, now we've got 18 million people. Against that, we've actually seen an ecosystem start to recover and positive trends. I think it's a good sign.
Great, thank you. And this is to Tom, but it also might involve you, Walt, as well. How does total nitrogen average for the Choptank ag-dominated watersheds compare to other Eastern Shore Chesapeake Bay tributaries and also to Western Shore tributaries?
That was addressed to me? I'm sorry. There's a funny echo up here on the stage. It was. Okay.
Yes, it was addressed to you.
Yeah, let's see. I did a comparison of the Susquehanna, the ag-dominated watersheds, Greensboro. I'd say that most of the tributaries on the Eastern Shore, there's a range of concentrations that really depend on the distribution of ag, forest, and urban land. So you can easily see if you get more urban or if you get more agriculture in a watershed, then you get higher concentrations. If you have more forest, you have lower concentrations. I'm not sure that I've looked carefully enough at a lot of other tributaries. I think the Chester is not too different from the Choptank. The Miles is probably slightly lower, but I think I'm not in a position to answer that quantitatively. But I could predict based on land use, you know, the more agriculture and urban areas you have, you're going to have higher concentrations, the more forest will be lower. So those are the real drivers. Soils play a role in there too, but the land use in the basin is the real driver. The more people, the more agriculture you have, the higher the nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment you're going to see in the water.
Thank you. And this is for Rich. How might the estimated load for nitrogen and phosphorus for the Choptank change in the next phase of the watershed model when nutrient inputs are updated and more best management practices are included that Maryland has in their watershed implementation plan but haven't been getting credit for?
Yeah, I think a couple of things that are going out there. On the plus side, we're going to be more accurate, I think, across the board because of the better land cover at a 1 meter resolution and then translate that to land use. Working with our Maryland colleagues to get a better back history of best management practices and capture those all the way out through 2015. We're going to have another decade worth of monitoring data in the streams and rivers and also the estuary to compare against. I think we're actually going to probably see higher phosphorus in there because we've been underestimating the amount on phosphorus saturated soils, and our monitoring data is indicating, particularly in the tidal waters, we're seeing some of that in the free-flowing streams. I think on the nitrogen, we actually might be a little tighter in there. So I think, I don't know quite yet the pluses and minuses. What I can say pretty assuredly is we're getting closer to that answer that we'll never actually have the full truth for, but I think we're gonna get closer to what we're seeing. And with the additional help of our USGS colleagues, the additional monitoring stations. So you all can join us on that particular journey. There are certainly the what we call beta versions of the partnerships phase 6 watershed model are up on the partnerships website. So if you're really having trouble sleeping tonight or over the weekend, roust up your spouse and say, hey, listen, let's go look at some calibration data. Let's look how it compares to water quality data out there, and eventually you'll see some yields, and by that time, he or she will have been snoring, but you'll be just fascinated with it. It's better than Hulu, and it's free now that Hulu's no longer free. So, but seriously, that we won't finish that calibration and ask the partners for a final check on that until June of next year. So we've got another 6 plus 7, 8 months to take a look at that information to understand that implications. But I think when we do have it out there, it's not likely to make things easier, but I think it's going to make them smarter. In other words, we're going to focus our time and efforts on where the most of the remaining loads are going to be there. We're going to be smarter about phosphorus-saturated soils. We're going to have the benefit of the groundwater lags in there and saying, hey, listen, how long do we think it's going to be respond? And then we can make smarter decisions about how we go about carrying out this work.
Great. Thank you. And the final one, which does not have a name attached to it, expresses a concern. Why aren't local governments identified as critical partners? Are they implementing or aren't they?
I'll make a stab at that. I think local governments are critical partners. They have to be engaged in this whole process in order for this to work. I think they're viewed as critical partners in the process as well, at least, I mean, I certainly do. We work very closely with Caroline County and those watersheds that we're, and you know, I work with the, a lot of the folks at the Department of Planning, and so they are, it's very, the action is occurring at the local scale. That's where things actually get done. You know, the federal government can set a framework or guidelines, and the state has does something else locally, and but the real, this action on the ground is really in the municipalities. We had an example of that for Cambridge earlier, and also in at the county level in terms of making programs available. So I those are, engaging the local government is essential.
Yeah, I think, take a look at the different source sectors. Wastewater, the biggies, the three big ones done. Maryland is actually moving into what we refer to as non-significant, not inconsequential, but non-significant compared to the big guys. You guys are making a dent in the Choptank on that. The other states are still finishing up their significance. The stormwater piece, I think Cambridge was a great example of that. You look at Jason's charts in terms of where the BMP practices are occurring out there. It is occurring here on the shore, and it's occurring at the conservation district level, the towns, the cities out there. So most definitely, are we going to ask a little bit more? Most likely, but still on the path that they are already currently under the phase two WIP. But I think we're going to go smarter about this, but we can certainly learn from what's happening here in the Choptank on the Eastern Shore and share that with other partners around the watershed.
Thank you.
Well, and as far as NOAA's habitat focus area goes, it's local governments are one of the key partners we've identified. I know that Joanna and the group that she talked about before will be trying to reach out to those, already has to some extent, but reaching out more broadly. And the group that I represent as part of the NOAA habitat focus area, the science team, along with Suzanne Skelly in the audience, are interested in trying to talk with those local leaders and find out what it is, what's the best way to package science, NOAA science, that can help them with some of the decisions they're trying to make. So one example is climate change. We've worked with the town of Oxford. There's a climate vulnerability assessment that was put together that's helping them plan how to sort of adapt for climate projections in that town. So we're interested in, you know, what other opportunities are there like that in the watershed where we can better deliver science at that local level.
Thank you. That ends the questions that we have. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for sticking with us through this afternoon. I have learned much. I hope you have as well. And thank you, Bobby Hutchison, for getting this going. And I also wanted to acknowledge the photographs when you came in that were on a loop. They were by David Harp, extremely well-known photographer here on the Eastern Shore and elsewhere. Again, ladies and gentlemen of past panels and of the current panel, thank you kindly for your time and your knowledge.